إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم تسليما كثيرا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله Indeed the most truthful of speech is the book of Allah وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم And the best guidance is the guidance of our beloved messenger Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها And the worst of affairs are those things we newly invent into this religion of ours. وَكُلُّ مُحْدَثَةٍ بِدْعَةٍ And everything we newly invent into this religion of ours is an innovation. وَكُلَّ بِدْعَةٍ ضَلَالَةٍ And every innovation is misguidance and it leads astray. وَكُلَّ ضَلَالَةٍ فِي النَّارِ Every going astray, every misguidance is in the hellfire. ثُمَّ أَمَّا بَعْدٍ My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, 8 years ago, give or take a couple of days, we had the journey to build this masjid. We put our trust in Allah, we purified our intentions, we set forth on a path to build this masjid, and by Allah's grace and bounty, we were able to do it. And we were driven by the message, the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, مَنْ بَنَى مَسْجِدًا يَبْتَغِي بِهِ وَجْهِ اللَّهِ بَنَى اللَّهُ لَهُ مِثْلَهُ فِي الْجَنَّةِ That whoever contributes to building a masjid, seeking out the pleasure of Allah's face, then Allah will build for him or her something similar in Jannah. And today we continue to see the fruits of that hard work and toil, the dua we made, the donations we gave, the sacrifice and the hopes 8 years later. But we asked at that time, so what do we do now? What is our duty? Do we sit back and relax and pat ourselves on the back saying, Alhamdulillah, we were part of a noble cause and the work is done? We said then and we continue to say no. But now the true test continues to be upon us. The true work now begins and it continues to be at our feet, at our hands for us to do. The true struggle to be upon the truth and in obedience to Allah and to His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So what have you done in these first 8 years? How have you used the masjid to better yourself, to benefit yourself and your families? كما قال الله يا أيها الذين آمنوا قوا أنفسكم وأهليكم نارا. O you who believe, Allah said what means, O you who believe, save yourselves and your families from the hellfire. Because its fuel is not gasoline and charcoal, its fuel is mankind, humans and stones. The Prophet ﷺ, he always reminded us with the heart. Questioning ourselves, looking at ourselves in the mirror, and questioning where our house, our heart stands. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَلَا وَإِنَّ فِي الْجَسَدِ مُضْغَ إِذَا صَلَحَتْ صَلَحَ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّ وَإِذَا فَسَدَتْ فَسَدَ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّ أَلَا وَهِيَ الْقَلْبِ The Prophet ﷺ, he said, indeed, there's a piece of flesh in the body. If it is sound, then the rest of you, the rest of your body, your actions will be sound. But if it is corrupt, then the rest of you will be corrupt. And indeed, that piece of flesh is your heart. And this hadith is in Bukhari and Muslim. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, as a reminder to us, يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهِ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ The day of resurrection, the day of fear, the day of a great calamity, the day where we will all be questioned by Allah. That is the day where Allah says, children and wealth will not avail you or benefit you. Except for whoever comes to Allah with a good, pure, clean heart. And if you come with that pure, clean heart, That is, this is the one who will be successful on that day. So we did the actions that were good actions. We struggled and donated and supplicated to Allah to let this masjid be built, for this project to come to fruition. And Allah, He made it easy for us. Subhanallah. So again, we ask you 8 years later, do we relax now? Is paradise guaranteed? Is it our belief that paradise is guaranteed, that Jannah is guaranteed for the one who says La ilaha illallah? Regardless of what actions they do, regardless of what actions they fail to do, is paradise guaranteed for us and no more work needs to be done? Again, the answer is no. We must strive and work hard until both of our feet are granted admittance into Jannah. It is said that the hearts of the righteous are concerned about how their life will end. And they're always wondering, what will my end be? Or how will our end be? This is the way the righteous person thinks. They're always concerned what will be their destination in the Akhirah. Remember that statement where our Prophet ﷺ, he was asked by a man to give me something, make it concise, but I don't want to ask nobody else after it. Just make it something that I don't have to ask anybody else for guidance after. He said, قُلْ آمَنْتُ بِاللَّهِ ثُمَّ اسْتَقِمْ. He said, say I believe in Allah and then have istiqamah, be steadfast upon that belief. This istiqamah, this steadfastness is not just that you believe something in your heart, but that your tongue follows through that belief. The actions of your limbs live out that belief. Your prayers, your charity, your fasting, your good deeds towards your family, towards your friends, towards your neighbors, towards the Muslim, towards the disbeliever, towards the non-Muslim alike. This is what being steadfast is. This is what is having istiqamah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, إِنَّمَا يَعْمَرُ مَسَاجِدَ اللَّهِ مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَأَقَامَ الصَّلَاةَ وَآتَ الزَّكَاةَ وَلَمْ يَخْشَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He clarified to us, the ones who will be the custodians and the caretakers, the ones who maintain the masajid of Allah. It's not the one who cleans it. It's not the one who supports it financially. He said the masajid of Allah shall be maintained by those who believe in Allah. And they believe in the last day. And they establish their prayers and they pay their zakat. And they fear none other than Allah. It is they who are expected to be upon true guidance. This is the one who maintains the masajid of Allah. So you must ask, if you're not one who believes, if you're not one who believes in Allah or the last day, if you're not one who establishes your prayers in the masajid of Allah or pays their zakat, then are you a maintainer of the masajid of Allah? You must ask yourself this, because this masjid isn't built for just Fridays or in Ramadan. And we have to get out of that vacuum that makes us think that way. The masajid of Allah shall be maintained means this is the ones who establish their prayers in the masjid. And they love attending their prayers and making their prayers in the masajid of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Remember our purpose of creation. Allah stated it in the Quran. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسِ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. Allah said that I have not created jinn or mankind except to worship me. This is the purpose of our creation. So we asked it 8 years ago and we continue to ask it today. Now that the masjid has been built, what is your next move? Do you use it to better yourself? Or do you use it to distance your... Or do you not use it at all? Do you use it to raise your children in it? To call people towards the deen of the truth? Brothers, fill in the gaps in every way you can, inshallah. Because, alhamdulillah, with the spread of the vaccinations and the easings of the restrictions, you can come, more of the brothers can fit into the main hall, barakallahu feekum. You still have your prayer mat. And a reminder, everyone must still wear the mask. Okay? Every Jum'ah, there's some complaints from the sisters' hall, the men's hall, of someone not wearing their mask. So please do so, barakallahu feekum. So we continue to ask, now that the masjid is built, what's your next move? Do you use it to better yourself, to raise your children in it, to call people towards Islam in it, or do you sit back and relax thinking you've done all the good you need to do in your life? When it comes to our children, we all claim that we love them and that they're the most important things of the people in our life, even though the parents should be above them. When it comes to the children, we claim we love them with all our heart, but what kind of love is it? When you watch your child walking into a fire and you do nothing to stop them. If there was a burning building and your child wanted to go back in there to get something, You would throw yourself on that child. You would hold them back and you wouldn't let them go into it. If there was a car that was ready to explode, gasoline was leaking from it, and there was a flame by it, you would stay 100 feet away. Loving your children does not mean giving them what they want. They want this video game here. They want these shoes here. They want this clothing here. This is not what love is. We've made love materialistic. And we know when there's materialism with a thing, it's empty. That love is empty. It's not real love. It's just giving something what they want because that's what they think love is, or love it how love is shown. Loving your child is giving them shade and protection on the day where there's no shade but the shade of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we have that from the authentic hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he said, سَبْعَةٌ يَظِلُّهُمُ اللَّهِ فِي ظِلِّهِ فَيَوْمَ لَا فِي ظِلَّ إِلَّا ظِلُّهُ. Seven who will be in the shade of Allah on a day where there's no shade except for the shade of Allah under His arsh, under His throne. Two of those categories, because that hadith is a topic in and of itself for a Jum'ah. Two of those were شَابٌ نَشَأَ بِعِبَادَةِ اللَّهِ, a child who's brought up worshipping Allah. How do you deny a child the masajid of Allah, the masjid of Allah, and you want them to know how important it is to worship Allah in the masajid? And the second one, رَجُلٌ قَلْبُهُ مُعَلَّقٌ فِي الْمَسَاجِدِ, and a man whose heart is tied to the masjid. A child who's brought up worshipping Allah, alone without partners, and a man whose heart is tied to the masjid. These can get you shade and protection. Again, if it's a hot day, you put sunscreen on your kids or you make them wear a hat. If it's a cold day, you give them a jacket or two or three. If it's raining, you give them an umbrella. All this protection in this dunya means nothing on the day of resurrection if you're not planting, making that canopy of shade on the day of resurrection, and you can do so by your actions. This isn't just a message to the brothers, because the sisters, your mothers, your sisters, your wives, your daughters. So you must encourage the men in your family to come to the masajid of Allah. So many of us may say that I'm a Muslim, but are you proud of it? What image of your deen do you carry out to the people when you walk, when you talk, when you act, the way you look? Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, he used to say, I fear the day when the disbelievers will be proud of their falsehood. And if we don't think that's happening, they're proud of their falsehood. They're proud of the gay pride. They're proud of their disbelief. The amount of energy that the disbelievers put into their falsehood and spreading their falsehood is unbelievable. He said, I fear the day where the disbelievers will be proud of their falsehood, but the Muslims will be shy of their deen, shy of their faith. Not wanting to pray in public, you'll miss prayers because you're shy, you're embarrassed to do so. Not wanting to wear a kufi or a thobe in public, you're embarrassed to do so. Not wanting to wear the hijab in public, the sister's embarrassed to do so. Not wanting to let people know you're a Muslim or you're fasting in public, you're embarrassed to do so. We have become shy of our faith, embarrassed by our faith in public. And this was something Umar al-Khattab, he even was afraid of happening. So 8 years later, what have we done? To be the Muslims we should be, the Muslim parents we should be, the Muslim husbands and wives we should be, the Muslim brothers and sisters to one another we should be. Not letting color of one's skin, not letting nationality, not letting languages we speak, not letting the wealth you have, not letting the status you think you have or the degrees you have divide and separate us. What have we done to be the brothers and sisters we should be? To show our neighbors, our colleagues, by example, how the Muslim is, how the Muslim should be. By educating ourselves and our families, and then educating others. This masjid and this community is so much more capable of doing more in the path of Allah and spreading the da'wah of Islam. But we fail to do so because we're so entrenched of just fulfilling our desires and living the happy dunya life that we think is everything, even though we know it's a temporary state. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, اِدْعُوا إِلَى سَبِيلِ رَبِّكَ بِالْحِكْمَ وَالْمَوْعِدَةِ الْحَسَنَةِ وَجَادِلْهُمْ بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says what means, call to the way of Allah. Call to the way of your Lord. So if you're never someone who wants to give da'wah, if you're never someone who wants to represent Islam or show Islam, you are failing a command that Allah gave you to carry out. Because this wasn't if you want to. This was if you are a Muslim and you want to be upon the right path, then you have to call to the way of Allah. We're not talking go door to door and stuffing a book in somebody's face. Even your simplest actions, the smile on your face, your kindness, your manners, your character will be da'wah for that person to learn Islam via. The command is upon us to call to the way of Allah, to the Muslim and the non-Muslim, with wisdom, with gentleness, with kindness, with the fair admonition, going back, referring, guiding with the Quran and the Sunnah, and not arguing with them in the manners that they may argue with us. If they curse or insult Islam or us, we don't curse or insult back. If they use foul language, we don't use foul language. If they raise their voices, we don't raise our voices, and the likes of these matters. So my dear brothers and sisters, 8 years later, do you think we've done a good job, or that our job is done, or that we have done enough? And there is no way we could think so. When it comes with respect to our neighbors, many of them who are still ignorant to what Islam is, because their only version is what they have via the media. Because again, we haven't done our job. When we look at the neighbors, they have rights upon us. Al-Hassan, he said, your neighbor isn't the one to your right and left behind you and in front of you. Your neighbor is 40 homes away. So stand on your spot of your door, the front porch or the front step of your door of your home. And 40 homes in each direction, this is your neighbors and they have rights over you. Have you ever thought of the fruits on your trees, just taking some of them to those neighbors? What da'wah that would give? What they could learn about Islam? They will come to know, they will come to ask. They will come to see. قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ مَنْ كَانَ يُؤْمِن بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ فَلْيُقْرِمْ جَارَهُ. The Prophet ﷺ, he said in the hadith, which is sahih in Bukhari Muslim, whoever believes in Allah on the last day should be kind and generous to his or her neighbor. Mujahid, it was narrated that he told Abdullah ibn Umar when he had sacrificed two sheep, he had said to him, have you given some of this sacrifice to your Jewish neighbor? He said, سَمِعْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ يَقُولُ مَا زَالَ جِبْرِيلُ يُوصِينِ بِالْجَارِ حَتَّى ظَنَمْتُ أَنَّ سَيُوَرِّثُهُ. This hadith which we have, which is sahih in the Sunnah of al-Tirmidhi, the Prophet ﷺ, he was heard to have said, Angel Gabriel, alayhi salam, he used to keep advising me about the neighbors so much that I thought he was going to make inheritance due to them from our wealth. This is how much the neighbors should be given their rights. They have rights over us, and we should be dealing with them in such good ways and not harming them, and this is something that time will tell. And I hope and I pray that our neighbors will at least learn about Islam by our actions, by our good ways, by our deeds. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, we've been in this masjid 8 years with the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What have you done to better yourselves through it? And at the same time, what have you done for it? أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم ادعو الله يغفر لكم ذنوبكم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونصلي ونسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا وبعد. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, I had seen this quote once, I don't know where it's from. But it said, be in such a way that those who come to know you but do not know Allah get to knowing Allah by knowing you. Again, live your life in such a way that people around you who do not know Allah, do not know Islam, do not know Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, through seeing you live your life, humility, humbleness, no arrogance, no pride, kindness, gentleness, generosity, the likes of these matters, they will come to know what Islam is. They will come to know who Allah is. They will come to know who the best of mankind that we are trying to live like is, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, 8 years later, this task is still at hand, if not more so than it was in the beginning. More than ever, we need to stand firm and show our deen so that we can defeat those who fear Allah. We can defeat that Islamophobia. And we can, by Allah's permission, change some of those hearts. We've seen it happen. Just by simple invitations to the masajid, people so shocked at hearing what they hear. When we would give the programs for teachers from the school district, I never knew this is what Islam said. I never knew Muslims believed in Jesus. I never knew Muslims believed in the Virgin Mary. I never knew Muslims had this thought, this belief, that belief. And why? But if nobody's giving da'wah, or if one person's giving da'wah, or if only three people are giving da'wah, then we're all failing the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My brothers and sisters in Islam, we're at a crossroads. We're a community vastly growing, fast, very fast. Alhamdulillah. And the masajid are going up everywhere. Alhamdulillah. But are we using the masjid the way it should be used? Because we have the duty to ourselves, to our families, to our children, to our brothers and sisters, to our neighbors, to our city, to the whole world, to call to the truth. And that al-Islam is the way of truth. COVID kind of threw a wrench in that. We had to close for periods of time. We cannot gather. The family night's out the door. The halakha's out the door. All these things. But we need to get back to that. We need to get back to that. Because this is where we're going to thrive. Islam is being defined by miscreants, by foolish people who claim to be pious and truthful. Why? Because the pious, truthful ones, they're silent. Why? Because we've chosen silence. We've chosen assimilation, to blend in, to look like the other, to act like the other, from the haircut to the clothing to everything we say and do. So much so that in public we won't even say salamu alaykum. It has to be what's up, bro. This is how much we've gone. Where's the fear? What are you afraid of? The reason why people have the image they have is because the pictures on the TV, on the social media, they're speaking louder than us. Again, because we've chosen silence, assimilation, to look the same, to dress the same, to hide our deen, to stay quiet out of fear. This is why Islam is free of anything evil. Islam is free from all the violence and terror that we see people commit in its name. Without a doubt. And if anyone thinks that is Islam, we're not doing our work. We keep shooting ourselves in the foot. We take 2 steps forward, we take 100 steps or 100 feet or 100 yards or 100 miles back, trying to teach Islam properly only for some cultural nonsense, cultural stupidity, bid'ah, innovations to come and overtake the true deen of Islam. I'm asking you to stop crying out. Stop pointing the finger. Oh, we're this way because of the West. You chose to come live here. Oh, we're this way because of Israel. No, we're not. Or we're this way because of the leaders of the Muslim. No, we're not. And it has to be said. This politics, when we have brothers, sisters, cursing the leaders of the Muslim lands, cursing the hukam, Hukam al-Muslimin, the leaders of the Muslim countries, because their emotions make them forget, their passion comes out and it trumps their deen, throwing takfir on the rulers, wal-ayyadu billah, saying that this ruler is a kafir, he's a disbeliever. Brothers, actually having the debate about someone who is a leader of a Muslim country, having a debate whether he's a Muslim or not. This is evil. This is major sin. This is not the aqeedah, this is not the way of the Salaf al-Salih, of the righteous predecessors of this ummah. You did not find the companions of Rasulullah ﷺ doing this towards the leaders of the Muslims. You did not find the tabi'een or the tabi'een, the four a'imma, the four imams, may Allah have mercy on them, or any of the righteous previous generations calling towards raising up against the leaders. We thought it was a good idea. Some people thought it was a good idea. It happened. You're telling me the bloodshed in Syria, the bloodshed in Yemen, the bloodshed in Afghanistan, the bloodshed that happened in Egypt, you think this was worth? What is? No, it's still destruction. There's still no Islam. There's still no taqwa. So I'm asking you, and I'm warning you, to cut it out before Allah holds you accountable. What is upon us, as Muslims who follow the Quran and the Sunnah, is to make dua for the leaders of the Muslim lands, that Allah guides them. Because even if they steal your wealth, even if they were to beat you, as comes in the authentic hadith, then you're still to obey them. The leaders of the Muslim lands, if you have a problem with them, look at yourself in the mirror. Or have the people of that country look at themselves in the mirror. Because the reflection of taqwa, of the rightness or the wrongness, of what state our heart is in, this is what the reflection of the leader is. The leader only represents the people who are of their kind and their mindset. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, rahimahullah, may Allah have mercy on him, said, it is not permissible for anyone among the people to fight under the ruler, nor rise up against him, And whoever does so is a mubtadi', he is an innovator. Upon other than the sunnah, not the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and upon other than salat al-mustaqim, he's upon other than the straight path. So I advise you with this. So what is essential for us is to begin with what we were commanded to do. To call people to tawheed, to the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because its concept is so easy to understand, it's so realistic. That Allah is one and that we should only worship Him and we should only praise Him and He's the sole Lord of the heavens and the earth. To the truth, to be pious, to be righteous, of course, on the proof from the Quran and the Sunnah, as understood and lived by the Sahaba radiallahu anhum wa ardahum. In order to do this correctly, we have to correct our character. And we can no longer afford delays in this issue. I am sick of hearing about Muslims who have, yani, the way I was learning it or hearing it, illat al-adab or illat al-akhlaq, having a lack of manners, a lack of character, a lack of good behavior, a lack of decency. I'm sick of hearing it. From the husbands in their treatment towards the wives, from the wives in their treatment towards the husbands, from the way the parents treat their children, from the way the children treat their parents, and just trickles down. The way we act as brothers and sisters of blood relations, silat al-rahim, keeping the ties of the family relations, to as brothers and sisters in Islam. My brothers and sisters in Islam, some reminders with respect to our character. قَالَ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ وَسَلَّمَ أَنَا زَعِيمٌ بِبَيْتٍ فِي أَعْلَى الْجَنَّةِ لِمَنْ حَسَّنَ خُلَقَ. The Prophet ﷺ, he said in the authentic hadith, I am a guarantor for a home in the highest of Jannah, not the lowest, not just inside its gates, not the middle, the highest of Jannah. I'm a guarantor. I will guarantee a home for a person in the highest of Jannah if they perfect their manners and their character and their behavior and their morals. The Prophet ﷺ, he told us, you can reach darajat al-sa'im al-qa'im, the level of the one who fasts every day and prays every night, even though you sleep and you snore from Isha till Fajr. Even if you don't fast one day other than Ramadan, you can reach the level of the one who does all that extra by perfecting your manners and your behavior and your character. He also said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, مَا مِنْ شَيْءٍ أَثْقَلُ فِي الْمِيزَانِ مِنْ حُسْنِ الْخُلُقِ. There is nothing heavier on the scales on the day of resurrection than your good manners and your good character and your good behavior. Our character is vital, and we no longer can afford to delay correcting our character. Being kind, being gentle, being easy, being forgiving, pardoning others if they wrong you, and the likes of this. Starting first and foremost with your parents and your spouses, your wives and your husbands, with your children, and going, of course, to your brothers and sisters in faith. So 8 years later, the burden is still on our shoulders. The responsibility is greater. We've been blessed to have this masjid as our home. So now what will we do? Will we take it as a blessing, use it to help to educate ourselves and our families, or will we abuse it and abandon it? The responsibility comes to us to prove to our children how the Muslim should be, and to prove to our neighbors what a Muslim is by his or her actions, and to show our colleagues at work what Islam is by the way we deal with them. Our character, our manners should be based on the Quran and the Sunnah. And upon the sunnah of our Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So now that responsibility is even greater. Without visiting the masajid, without our hearts being attached to the masajid, without our children being raised up worshipping Allah, then this is just another building. And it would be such a sad thing to call it another building. It would be a sad thing to not call it a masjid, and it's just another foundation with four walls or eight walls or whatever it is, and a roof. That would be a sad thing. You can say, well, I teach my children at home. They go on Skype and they do all this and they do it. The home of your deen is in your heart. That's where the taqwa is going to reside. And a heart that does not have a love for the masjid in it, a heart does not have a person who visits the masjid in it or supports the masjid in it, then this is a heart which is broken or a heart which is weak. As a reminder, quickly, because of the importance of this topic, Amr ibn Maymun, rahimahullah, he said the companions of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to say the masajid, al-masajid buyutullah, the masajid, the mosques are the homes of Allah, the houses of Allah on earth, and it is a right from Allah that He will honor those who visit Him. When you come here, you're not coming to say you did something. You're coming as a guest of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Prayer in the masjid. When he was on his deathbed and he would peek out of the curtain, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, of his room, because he could see the message directly. What brought a smile to the face of the Prophet ﷺ even during his days of death, fi sakrat al-maut, was seeing his companions establishing the prayer in the masajid. Coming to the masjid, praying in jama'ah, you get 27 times more the reward. Jum'ah will not make the masjid, will not make the ummah, nor will Ramadan by itself. Even coming and sitting and waiting for the salah, لا يزال العبد في صلاة ما كان في مصلاه ينتظر الصلاة وتقول الملائكة اللهم اغفر له اللهم ارحمه. Even if you come to the masjid and you just come a little early to sit in your place of prayer, the malaika, they say, oh Allah, forgive him. Oh Allah, have mercy on him. This is for the one who waits for the imam to come. So they're waiting for the imam to come. The malaika, the angels are making dua for you. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu, he said, وَإِن صَلَّيْتُمْ فِي بَيُوتِكُمْ كَمَا يُصَلِّ الْمُتَخَلَّ فِي بَيْتِهِ لَتَرَكْتُمْ سُنَّةَ نَبِيِّكُمْ. And if you were to pray in your homes, as some of the laggards and the lazy people do, then you would have indeed left the sunnah of your Prophet ﷺ. And he continued to say, and whoever leaves the sunnah of Prophet Muhammad ﷺ has gone astray. قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ الْأَبْعَدُ فَالْأَبْعَدُ مِنَ الْمَسْجِدِ أَعْظَمُ أَجْرًا. The furthest one from the furthest one from the masjid has the greatest reward and the greater reward. And lastly, Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he was asked about the person who prays and he fasts, but he does not attend the jama'ah prayer in the masjid. He said, huwa fi an-nar. The person prays, the man. And mind you, this manhood doesn't begin at 18 or 21 like it does in here. It begins when your child hits puberty. For the men to establish the prayer in the masjid. He said, what if the person prays and fasts, but he doesn't pray jama'ah in the masjid? Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, one of the ones who the Prophet ﷺ, he gave tazkiyah for being knowledgeable about the tafsir of the Quran, he said, this person is in the hellfire. So my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, this building, we can look around it, we can say it's beautiful. It's not beautiful, it's not being visited. It's just another building. Use this masjid and serve this masjid. We could do so much more to have other people enter Islam, so much more to have people understand Islam, if we stop being lazy and stop being self-centered and stop being about me, 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 and doing something for Allah, doing something for the cause of Islam. Because if you want help in your life, it's by helping Allah. And Allah, though Allah doesn't need it, He has said that helping Him is by spreading His deen. So may Allah make us of those who are the ones who rush to coming and maintaining the masajid by believing in Allah on the last day, establishing our prayers in it, paying our zakah, and fearing none other than Allah. Allahumma ighfir lil muslimin wal muslimat wal mu'minin wal mu'minat al ahya minhum wal amwat innaka anta sami'un qareeb mujib al da'wat ya muqallib al qulub thabbit qulubana ala deenik ya muqallib al qulub thabbit qulubana ala deenik ya muqallib al qulub thabbit qulubana ala deenik subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun wa salamun ala al mursalin walhamdulillahi rabbil alamin wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.